All nations, y'all ready? Y'all stand up. Get on your feet right now. We about to do the chant. Y'all stand up right now. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go. Tell them it's good to see you this morning. All right, we good? All right. All right, y'all ready? Let's take it out. Let's finish this thing out.
Family, it's Apostle, and I'm standing in our brand new home, and I can't wait, and I know you can't, to get this thing accomplished. We are literally finished up with phase one. Now's the time for us to put some seed in the ground. We are almost there, guys. We are almost there. And when I'm saying that, I'm saying on June 7th, as a congregation, as a family, but not just our church, but houses around the entire country and people who are watching us online, believe in this vision, believe in this mission, believe in us. This is our opportunity to sow. So I want you to go on the screen right there. Here, there's some information here where you can log in and you can log on and you can sow a seed to the Paid in Full of 2020. We're going to get this thing done to the glory of God. We're going to build God a house that soon we'll be able to occupy, but not just that, we'll be able to do incredible things in the community. But with this facility, our efforts will be multiplied because we'll have the opportunity and the tool, the resource in a facility to house multiple community efforts in addition to our ministry. So I'm excited about all that God is doing. I know you believe in us and we appreciate your support. But now June 7th is we're gonna do it collectively as a family as we reemerge in all nations. Listen, put your seed in the ground. God blesses those who partner with the kingdom of God. And as you prayerfully have considered to partner with us for this year, whether you're part of the house or a part of the extended family in the body of Christ, I want you to go onto the information that's on the screen, allnations.com. You can find the Paid in Full tab. You can sow, give there. We are excited about it. We can't wait to partner with you so that we can get this thing built to the glory of God. Again, we're excited about Paid in Full. We hope you are, and that we look forward to seeing what God does on June 7th. You can give all the way up until, or you can give actually on June 7th. Again, we appreciate your support in advance, local churches, local pastors, people from across the globe. We appreciate you here at All Nations Worship Assembly of San Antonio, where we find family, discover purpose, change the world.
Welcome and good morning, all nations. How are y'all doing? I'm super excited.
They asked us back.
They did. They asked us back, huh?
One more time.
Who are we to judge?
One more again.
Who are we to say no?
Yeah,
what?
Lord.
We are here. But yes, okay. So we got all that out the way, Chris.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I am so excited about last week. Man, the new sermon series, Us. Motives. Didn't y'all get it?
Us.
Not them.
But us.
Us.
Oh yeah, it's a good series. Man, I'm enjoying it already.
I am enjoying it, and I just cannot wait to see what Apostle has to release today.
Oh yeah, I'm excited about that, but I am excited because today at 6:30, we have a pull-up party.
You better pull up.
Yeah, they have some requirements. You need to wear a mask. Mm. And you need to stay by your car.
We're pulling up to Rolling Oaks Mall.
Not North Star. Yeah, North Star, you're at the wrong place.
You're at the wrong mall.
You need to go to Rolling Oaks Mall tonight at 6:30 for our pull-up party.
30.
It's going to be live. We get to see everybody. It's so good for us all to come together. I know Pastor Lisa is excited.
I am.
Apostle to see everybody. We want to see everybody.
We're going to give our air hugs.
Oh, yeah. That's happening. Not the touching.
Not the real one, but the air. Yeah. That's clear.
So tag all nations, partners, everybody you know, let them know that we're gonna be at Rolling Oaks Mall at 6:30 p.m. tonight.
You know what though? They also need to pull up on Tuesday night.
Pull up Tuesday. Where are we going?
Our Bloom Zoom. Let me tell you.
It'd be
off the chain. They had me in tears for like literally a week, 2 weeks, because people were just gave. It turned in from the little things, and everybody was just like, it turned into the big things. I mean, if you better show up to Bloom Zoom.
Show up.
You better be a woman.
Can we show up?
You cannot. I'm sorry. Okay. It is for the Bloom women of all nations.
Okay.
Huh? So make sure you come and join us at 7:30 this coming Tuesday. Don't you be late. It's going to be awesome.
So take everything. I don't want it. I don't need it. God, won't you take everything? I don't want it. I don't need it. God, I just want you. I just want you. I just want you. I just want you. We just want you. We just want you, yeah. We just want you. We just want you. So take.
over here texting.
Oh, we don't live right now.
No, I'm texting to give.
Oh, texting to give.
Yeah.
Oh, make sure, you know, we got to do our paid in full, right? Is that what we're doing? Right, we're doing our paid in full. Paid in full is June 7th, people. June 7th. Say it with me. Put it in the chat, Mike. You might as well do that. Put it in the chat.
June 7th.
J, that's capital J, U-N-E, 7th, 2020.
Oh, yeah.
All day. All day on June 7th.
You can get it.
I want you to partner with this house. Let me tell you, oh my gosh, the frames is going up. I've been to the house. It is awesome. If you want to schedule a time,
I can't wait.
You can't wait? I can't wait either. I was about to say you want to schedule a time, but I'm going to pull that back.
Yeah, go pull that back.
We're not going to schedule it because we want the big reveal. And we want to see what your seed went to. Yes. So make sure. All we need is about, I would say, 500 people to give $1,000.
Come on with
me. We there.
You there.
Or 1,000 people to give $500.
Come
either
on.
Way, that would do it for us. I need you, seriously though, guys, I need you to partner with this work. This is good ground,
yes.
And you do not want to look up and say, I didn't give to that paid in full. Do that for us, in Jesus' name. Now, speaking of giving,
yes.
Let's go to offering, because it is offering time.
Yeah, I got to give
now you can text again. Let me do this.
I got to give it.
Let's see. All right.
Yeah.
It went through. And see, and you get the little text back, huh?
Uh-huh.
Just like this. You get the little text back. It says the gift is complete.
Uh-huh.
Look at God. Give. I want you to jump off right now. Just for a second. Give. Come right back.
Yeah.
Come right back. Give and come right back. What you guys say?
Give and come right back.
Give and come right back.
That's the order.
That is the order. Give and come right back. Give
and come
right back.
What I hope you gave
and came right back. Because
we're about to enter into a time of worship and words. I want you to stop what you're doing, grab your pen and your pad, and get ready to take good notes as we enter in and worship and hear the word.
Yes.
Stay tuned.
Stay tuned.
From the start, before the beginning of time, with no point of reference, he spoke to the dark and fleshed out the wonder of light. And as you speak, 100 billion galaxies are born in the vapor of your breath. The planets formed. If the stars were made to worship, so will I. I can see your heart in everything you've made. Every burning star, a signal fire of grace. If creation sings your praises, so will I. So will I. God of your promise, you don't speak in vain, no syllable empty or void. for once you have spoken. All nature and science follow the sound of your voice. Voice. And as you speak, 100 billion creatures catch your breath. Evolving in pursuit of what you say. If it all reveals your nature, so will I. I can see your heart in everything you say. Every painted sky, a canvas of your grace. If creation still obeys you, so will I. 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 If the stars were made to worship, so will I. If the mountains bow in reverence, so will I. If the oceans roar your greatness, so will I. For if everything exists to lift you high, so will I. If the wind goes where you send it, so will I. If the rocks cry out in silence, so will I. If the sum of all our praises still falls shy, then we'll sing again 100 billion times. Oh, 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 oh. God of salvation, you chased down my heart through all of my failure and pride. On a hill you created, the light of the world, abandoned in darkness to die. But as you speak, 100 billion failures disappear. Where you lost your life so I could find it here. If you left the grave behind you, so will I. I can see your heart in everything you've done. Every part designed in a work of art called love. If you gladly chose surrender, so will I. I can see your heart a billion different ways. Every precious one, a child you died to save. For one measure could amount to your desire. You're the one who never leaves the one behind.
Mm-hmm.
Good morning, All Nations. I'm so excited that you're here with us this morning, logged in and ready for another sermon, another message from our new series, Us. And if you're a first-time guest, I want to take a moment to welcome you. Thank you for being a part, you and your family. I want you to make sure that you take good notes, because today we're going to tackle some issues and tackle some things that I believe are going to help you in the midst of this pandemic that we are still walking through. And I believe that this series is going to be one that helps us engineer new habits, new ways of thinking, that as we come out of this and reemerge out of this season, that we'll be better people to the glory of God. And so as we're recapping a little bit on this idea of Us, the movie Us, we know it's about, that Jordan Peele wrote this about a family that is faced with what they call doppelgangers, which is literally an apparition or a double of a living person. Some will say even a ghost, but the parallel is showing us that there's who we are and then there's who we really are, or there's who we want people to believe we are, and then there's who we are inwardly. And so oftentimes who you are in the eyes of others is the best representation of your potential character, that we show people our potential, who we are potential to be. But in reality, our inward reality contradicts with what people see. And I think that's oftentimes the storyline of many of us, is that who we present before everybody else is not necessarily who we are inwardly. And as you're living in this quarantine, as just by yourself, as you are sheltering in place, let me tell you something. Right now, many of the things that you have, you know, somewhat put on the back burner, have walked away from, are now starting to resurface. And for many of you, reintroducing themselves back into your story and reintroducing themselves back into your mind and into your habitual nature, into your habits, into your daily regimen. So our assignment today, my assignment is simply to just help you begin to walk out, first of all, identify it, but then be truthful and transparent so that you can walk out of some of the very things that's been trying to grip you or has gripped you in time past. I want you to look at 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 16. This is a very powerful scripture that I believe is going to bless you just like it blessed me. And this is Peter writing to the five churches, and he says this: act as free men. I want you to say that after me and put that in the chat real quick. I need to act as a free man. He says, act as a free man and do not use your freedom as a covering for evil, but use it as bond slaves of God. He says, do not use your freedom as a covering for evil, that you can act as a free man. You are a free man, a free woman. You have the liberality and the freedoms to do whatever you can do that's lawful. However, don't use your freedoms as a covering to do foolish things. And I believe that every person, whether you're breathing as a Christian or you're breathing as a non-believer, all of us have this one word that I need to make sure we address while we're dealing with us. And that is vice. Vice. Put that in the chat right now. Vice. Vice. What is a vice, you may be asking, Apostle? What is a vice? What is a vice? A vice is a wicked or depraved conduct. That's one translation. Wicked or depraved conduct. That is a vice. The Apostle Peter said that Christians are free from the law, but not free to do wrong, he says. He says, we should not use our Christian freedom as a cloak for our vices. So we act as free men, but we don't use our freedom as a covering to do evil things. But when you are quarantined and when you're by yourself, I'm about to get personal, the vices begin to manifest. And I know I'm telling the truth, because many of you have been welcoming things back into your journey that you walked away from. And now those things are re-entering into your storyline and are frustrating you and possibly even tormenting you by now. But good news is coming to you. A vice is an ethical term. It's an inner disposition to perform wrong acts of a certain kind. It's a tendency to sin habitually in a particular manner. A vice is primarily the inner disposition to act in a certain manner, and not necessarily the act itself, but the engine that's causing you to do it. That's the vice. The vice. We, you know, oftentimes when you have something that you're building and you need a vice grip for it, it's the vice is what holds it in place. It holds things in a grip. It holds things in its grip. And oftentimes what the vice wants to do in your story is hold you in a particular place. It doesn't want you to move. It wants to keep you still so it can have its way with you. And many of you have been crying out to God, I don't know how I got back here. I've been trying to get away from from this, and I'm gonna help you out in a moment, but I've been trying to get away from this, but this vice, these vices have now gotten me to the place where I can't handle things on my own. I'm having difficulty moving away from this vice. The Bible says in Romans chapter 7, verse 18, I'm gonna read the scripture to you, and it's going to be amazing. I know you've heard it before, but this is the New Living Translation's version of this, and I hope it blesses you like it blesses me. It says this, and I know, Paul says, and I know that nothing good lives in me. Nothing good lives in me. That is, he says, in my sinful nature. So he's not saying that you don't have any good in you. He's saying that in your sinful nature, nothing dwells good in that place. He says, I want to do what is right, but I can't. I want to do what is good, but I don't. I don't want to do what is wrong, but I do it anyway. But if I do what I don't want to do, I am not really the one doing wrong. It is sin living in me that does it. Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 20, New American Standard reads this. It says, indeed, there is not a righteous man on earth who continually does good and who never sins. I'm going to repeat that again because this scripture just really slapped my whole head off. It says, indeed, there is not a righteous man on earth who continually does good and who never sins. Let me stop you right there. I know many of us have had this thought process that, man, perfection, we can earn that. We can earn the righteousness of God. We can earn by doing right things, and we can be right. I can be saved all day, no evil. No, that's a lie from the pit. It says the righteous man, Solomon says, even the righteous man on earth, there's not a righteous man on earth who continually does good and who never sins. No righteous man. He didn't just say a man. He said a righteous man or woman. Nobody can continually do good and not sin. Psalm 90, verse 8, says this. You have placed our iniquities before you, the writer says, our secret sins in the light of your presence. So I'm dealing with this idea of us, but looking at this storyline of vices, how these are the secret things, the things nobody knows, the things that are hidden, the things that are on the inward man, but they're not to be revealed yet. The things that you know about, God knows about, but nobody else knows about. I'm going to deal with these vices. These are the iniquities, the secret sins that are hidden before men, but seen by God. Psalm chapter 19, verse 12 says it like this in the New Living Translation. How can I know all the sins lurking in my heart? Let me stop there. The question is asked, how can I know all the sins lurking in my heart? Which means it's a trapping here because the writer saying, how can David saying, how can I know? How is it that I can know all of the potential of foolishness that I would get into? See, oftentimes we find ourselves in things we never thought we'd find ourselves in because we don't know the potential of all that's in our heart. The writer says, cleanse me from these hidden faults. Keep your servant from deliberate sin. And don't let them control me. Stop right there. He says, don't let my vices control me. I'm asking God not to let my secrets, my vices control me, because those things have the potential to suffocate you just like a doppelganger. It's the other side of who you are that no one knows until it's revealed. Uh-oh. He says, then I will be free of guilt and innocent of great sin. Psalm 32, verse 3, and I'm almost there, says this. When I refused to confess my sin, my body wasted away and I groaned all day long. It is possible to be trapped in the cycle and the system of your vice so much so that you've learned to master the representation publicly, but at home you're wasting away. Especially in this season, Because now you're groaning all day long because you're trying to stop what you opened the door back up to. And it's frustrating you and it's disappointing you and it's causing you great anguish and great sorrow and great grief. But it's a vice. It's a vice that wants to kill you. Hey, it wants to destroy you. Look what it says here, verse 4. Day and night, your hand of discipline was heavy on me. My strength evaporated like water in the summer heat. Verse 5 says, finally, I confessed all my sins to you, and I stopped trying to hide my guilt, my vice. I said to myself, I will confess my rebellion to the Lord, and you forgave me, and all my guilt is gone. There's a way out. Let's talk about some of these vices for a moment, because some of the vices that you're probably thinking, where's Apostle going with this? But now I'm about to get into your house. Now I'm about to come into your storyline for a moment. Here it is. Coping vices. Coping vices. It looks like drugs. Some of you right now at a place where you've been. You've been literally not knowing, hey, not thinking that anybody, because you're by yourself, no one can pick you up, no one can discern, no one can tell what's going on. But you're finding yourself now at the bottom of a bottle. You're finding yourself on the other end of some weed, the other end of whatever. You're finding yourself opening up to coping vices because you don't like being by yourself and you so hate being by yourself. You so hate this season. You so hate not being able to face the reality of who you really are, that it's easier to just drink it away. It's easier to distract it by smoking it away. It's easier to just take the pill and swallow it away. It's easy to do that. It's easy to get lit. It's easy to cause yourself to move to a place where you don't want to deal with reality and what really is happening on the inside of who you are, who you really are. That it's easier to just do these other things, and the whole time you're doing it, you're just coping. You're coping with a vice. The vice of drugs, the vice of alcohol. Here's another vice, the vice of masturbation. You're by yourself. See, these are the things nobody wants to talk about on Sunday, but you're quarantined. You have no way to get away from this. Masturbation, where you delete the cookies off your phone. You're deleting cookies off your phone because you really want to reset, but it's hard to reset. It's the vice, baby. It's what it is. It is what it is. You're in a place now where you're by yourself and you used to be able to get out and do this. And now, because life has closed in and things are silent and you're sitting at home alone and it's just you and you want to masturbation, porn, pornography, pornonia, looking at images, imagery, people having evil sexual encounters that's causing you to literally be aroused in your flesh. Yeah, I'm talking to you. We're coming for all the smoke today. This thing of pornography that's, you have the impressions in your head and the memories seared now with the thoughts of people you will never meet. Ha, 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 ha. Yeah, I'm talking to you because I know you're probably saying, Pastor, this thing is getting serious, but I'm talking to the secret places that dwell in us. Ha, the stuff nobody knows. Ho, ho, the stuff nobody knows that dwells in us. Yeah, yeah. Waiting till late so nobody knows that you're watching porn. That you're watching porn, putting it in your AirPods and your headbuds or whatever, and just trying to make sure that nobody can see you. You have it taped. You screen record it. It's in your phone, and now so you can go back and watch it whenever you want to. And pornography, anger, another vice. These are the vices that show up when you're by yourself. Anger is the vice that comes that when you're so ticked off, you find yourself just throwing things around the house and slamming your house shoes down and arguing with the kids for unnecessary reason, yelling at your husband, yelling at your spouse, yelling at people that call you, yelling at those after the Zoom call. You're frustrated, throwing dishes down, don't want to wash the dishes. You're kicking in the air, swinging in the air and profusely crying because you're full of anger. You can feel the heat in your chest. I'm talking to you. And that vice of anger that's beyond frustration. nation, the one that makes you want to cuss, the one that makes you do cuss. Yeah, I'm talking to you. Those of you who got foul language coming out on a regular basis, you're saying, I never talk this way. This is not the way I talk. What's going on with me? But the truth of the matter is, you're by yourself, and because you're by yourself, who you really are starting to manifest, and you got to pull that thing under control before you lose it. Oh, before you lose it. Anger. Yeah, I know the tears are falling down your face. I'm talking to you. I'm trying to help you. The blood of Jesus, even in this jumpsuit, represents him trying to flood out that anger, flood out that frustration. And you don't even know why. That's how you know it's a vice. You don't even know how you got here to so much anger, so much vengeance, so much revenge, so much rage on the inside of us. Bitterness, another vice. Bitterness is different than unforgiveness, because bitterness is unforgiveness out of control. Bitterness is no longer about this person. It's about people now. It's when you make moves from a place of bitterness. You're consistently pessimistic. And in this quarantine, some of you have invited bitterness back into your story. You were doing good at church because you had a distraction. You had a place to wave your hands. You was doing good when you had people to come and fellowship with you and eat and break bread. You were doing good. But now that you're by yourself, you got to deal. You got to deal with the bitterness, how mean and how nasty on the, and how vile and disgusting. Ha ha ha. Some of that stuff feels to deal with the bitterness. Here's another one. You ready for another vice? I know this is tough. I know this is tough. I know it is, but food. food. You need a lock on your refrigerator, because instead of dealing with you, you'd rather eat. You'd rather eat yourself into an oblivion. You'd rather eat to satisfy and to pass the time. You'd rather eat. You'd rather hurt your physical man, and you got this thing ticking on the inside of you telling you it's time to eat, even though you already ate. It's 2 o'clock in the morning and you're eating. It's 2 o'clock in the morning and you got donuts and ice cream. It's 2 o'clock in the morning and you're making breakfast at 2 o'clock in the morning. Why? Because it's a vice trying to grip you. It's trying to suffocate your life. And if you allow it and you don't come out of this season and out of this time with great authority over who you are, it's going to destroy you while you're in your solitude, while he has you separated, while he has you by yourself. It's going to try to kill you. Self-hate. Self-hate is I don't like me. I don't like me. I don't like me. It was okay. I can hide around other people. I can be with other people. I can talk to other people. I can fellowship with other people. Thank you, Lord. I can deal with other people, but now I don't like me. I'm realizing, some of you are realizing for the first time, that while you're by yourself, you don't like you. The truth of the matter is, it's not that you needed everybody around you to recharge. You're not an introvert who needs to recharge with people. No. You don't like you. And because you don't like you, this is challenging to deal with. Let's just be honest, y'all. Let's be honest, beloved. I know this ain't the traditional storyline, but we're dealing with us. Come on, family. We're talking about us. You don't like you. You say you like you. You post things online about how much you like you. You take pictures with a certain filter at a certain angle because you say you like you. You take pictures up here because you don't like your body type. You say you like you, but you really don't like you. You don't like you. And because it's difficult to like you, you move yourself into a place of jealousy. It's a quarantine, and many of us are jealous of other people. How can you be by yourself and still find time to be jealous of somebody else's journey? Jealous. The quarantine got us jealous of one another. Help me, Holy Spirit. Jealousy leads to senses of competition. Now we're competing to see who can do what. Churches are competing because churches are quarantined. Who has the best this? Who has the best vocals for their praise team? Who has the best cinematography? Who's preaching the best? Who can still close it, Doc? Who has the most views? All because we're quarantined. And I believe in this season that God is trying to pull out of people, I said it last week, the motives, not how you do a thing, but the why you do a thing. But while you sit in that bedroom, while you sit on that couch, I want to talk to you real quick about this thing. Devices. Devices. That's how you deal with us. The doppelganger. The part of you that don't nobody know. The part of you that you don't want nobody to see. Deals with competition. Bad relationships. It's another vice. That because you've been so quarantined, now you settle for anybody that calls you. You got a person who you know is no good, means you no good, has no intention with a future with you, doesn't like you, maybe physical with you, or have been verbally abusive toward you, and you still settle for that foolishness. Why? Because it's a vice, and it wants to hold you still, stop your progression. Ah, but we coming for the vices today. We coming for the vice today. Here's another vice. You ready? Fear. Fear. Over the last 7 weeks, fear has tried to reintroduce itself to your story, has tried to reintroduce itself to your life, has tried to reintroduce itself in your dreams. As a matter of fact, there's someone watching right now, and night terrors have been assailing you and have been coming after you and have been apprehending you. I don't know who I'm talking to. Lift your hands where you are at your home, and in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I rebuke night terrors. Command night terrors to let you go. Ho, ho, ho. To let you go now. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Night terrors are waking you out of your sleep. Woo! Moments where you think you're about to die. Anxiety at the point where it's gripping your imagination and your thought processes, and you can feel your heart beating out of your chest and you're scared that you're going to die. Anxiety that got you believing that you have a disease or a virus. Now you're not even sick, but it's in your head because of the anxiety. It's what's dealing with us. It's in the inside of us. In the inside of us. Anxiety. Loneliness. The vice of loneliness. And now that enemy is whispering, you should take your own life. Nobody would care. Nobody's going to see you. It doesn't even matter. Nobody's called you. Ha! But the devil is a liar. You got to fight back in this season, beloved. You got to fight back in this season. You got to fight back in your head and say, this is not going to take me out. I'm going to deal with the things nobody else knows about who I am. And God sent this message just in time. To unearth to you in your home, in your restroom, in your bathroom, in your bedroom, in your living room, in your vehicle, in your garage. Hallelujah. And some of you are probably at the verge of trying to do something to yourself today. You said this was going to be the last Sunday, but the devil is a lie. Loneliness. Lastly, the vice of depression. Depression. Depression, the vice that makes you feel like it's not even worth being here anymore. That it never gets better. Y'all, this is the lie of the enemy. But I got some good news. You ready for some good news? The good news is you don't have to contend. You don't have to deal with. You don't have to dwell. You don't have to swim around in. You don't have to be victim to this vice any longer if you don't want it. Are you ready? Here's the good news. It's found in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. I'm going to give you this, and I'm going to get out of your face. It says this, he made him, meaning he being God, he made him who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf. Stop right there. It literally means that Christ can meet you in your struggle. Why? Because he became your struggle. He became your vice. Hallelujah. He became the very thing that's trying to attack you, trying to distract you, trying to hurt you, trying to kill you. He became it. He became your secret. He became it. He became it. No matter how ugly it is, no matter how nasty it is, no matter how vile it is, no matter how incredibly crazy and insane you may think it is, he became your worst insanity. He became your sin. He became your vice. He became your vice so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. He became your vice so that you could be righteous. I came to tell somebody, there's not a vice that you have, to include the ones I named or the ones I didn't name, that's so bold, so bad, so evasive, so challenging that Jesus, he couldn't touch it. He became your sin. God put all of our vices on his son so that we can become the righteousness of God. You're watching this and you're feeling convicted. Hallelujah. Some of you are convicted right now, and you're convicted to the point where you're like, you know what? I got to get this together because these vices have been destroying my life. No one knows it. These things have been happening in me. I get up, I dance, I shout, I praise, I preach, I sing, I minister, I serve. But at the same time, I go home to these vices. And if you're watching this, I know you are, and you're saying, Apostle, I need to be made free. I'm sick and tired of these vices destroying my soul. I'm groaning daily with disappointment in my soul disposition because of this thing that is killing me daily. I can't keep my hands off myself. The imagery is tearing me apart. If you're watching this and you're saying, Apostle, I need to come clean. I need to come out of this. Don't you go nowhere. Stay right there. I'm going to pray this prayer with you very quickly. Shout it with me. Father, you said in your word, come on, say that with me. You said in your word that if I confess my sins, that you are faithful and you are just to forgive me of all sin and to cleanse me, come on, say that, from all unrighteousness. Lord, I'm sorry. Forgive me for every vice. Forgive me for the things you know that I'm wrestling with now. I ask you to forgive me. And I break covenant with these things in Jesus' name. I just heard this. For some of you, it's pride. For some of you, it's pride. Right now, it's pride. It's pride. Pride just sprung up. Pride just sprung up and said, no. You okay. You perfect. You good. You ain't got none of those problems. See, if you, that devil thought he's going to get away. If you think that the only vices were the things I named, you're tricking yourself and the enemy's trying to manipulate you out of your freedom. No, you know what that vice is. Father, forgive me. I receive your forgiveness now in Jesus' name. Let me pray for you. Father, I thank you for every man, every woman that's watching this today, watching this morning, wherever they are. I bless them for the courage to admit, and you said it there, if we confess our faults to you, that you're faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Lord, I thank you that you have cleansed them and you're cleansing them from all unrighteousness. So now in Jesus' name, I add my faith to their faith and I decree and I declare that they are forgiven. Now we command the power of every evil vice, every illegal struggle, every illegal scheme that has been hidden in this storyline that torments them. In the name of Jesus, I ask you to break the power of it now. Holy Spirit, you're the healer and you're the deliverer. There's no power that I have except for in your name, Jesus. Lord, I thank you that the Holy Spirit has the ability to sweep that room. I ask you, Father, invade that space, sir. That's the healing power of Jesus Christ touching you now. Hey, invade that space, Father. Invade. Ooh, I feel the presence of God is falling in some. The presence of God is falling in your homes right now. It's falling in your homes, right? Hey. It's falling. Hallelujah. And I heard the Lord just say that for many of you, he's been waiting on you to admit this so he can heal you in your physical man. Ha! For some of you, the impairment in your body is connected to your ability in the covenant you made to stay in this vice. No. The Lord says, I'm healing you. Hey. Rapha is here to heal you. Hey, not just to heal your emotional man, not just to heal your psychological man, but I'm here to heal your physical body in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. I thank you that the Holy Spirit is ministering in your homes. He is ministering on your job. He is ministering to you now in the name of Jesus. And we give him praise for it now. Worship him where you are. This is how he heals us.
This is how he deals with us in the transparent places, the secret places. Somebody's got to say it. How can they heal without a preacher? Somebody's got to do it. He's healing you in those secret places, even now. We give you praise for it. Jesus' great name. Listen, there's somebody watching. You're not a Christian. You haven't given your heart to Christ yet. You haven't done it. I want to invite you to come to Jesus Christ. I want to invite you to come to Jesus. He died for your sins. I said it earlier so that you can be the righteousness of God. I want you to know that you can be in right standing with God and you don't have to earn it. Christ became your struggle so that the distance and the gap between us and him could be closed and that you can be the righteousness of God, consequently securing your space and your place in heaven with the Father. If that's you and you're not a Christian and you're ready to give your heart to Christ, I want you to repeat this prayer after me. Father, I believe you have a son. I believe his name is Jesus. I believe he died for my sin. Come into my heart, Jesus. Make my life brand new. I give you my life for the rest of my life. In Jesus' name. If you prayed that prayer today, I want to welcome you to the body of Christ. That's it. What I want you to do right now, I want you to go to the church, make the devil out a liar, and I want you to say, I'm saved. Right now, I'm saved. If this is your first time praying that prayer, you were not a Christian, you wasn't certain you were going to heaven, go to the church right now and say, I'm saved. One of our persons, our leaders, our counselors are going to come on there. They're going to get you right there. Now listen. On the screen, you'll see www.allnationssa.com/welcome. I want you to click that link. Jump off this live, click that link now. And I want you to fill out that form. Let us know you gave your heart to Christ. We're going to contact you. We're not going to let you walk through this journey by yourself. We're not going to let you go. There's another person here. Several of you who are coming back to Christ. You were already a Christian, but you're coming back to Jesus. You're coming back. You decided, man, this message messed me up. I never heard anything preached like this. I never heard this thing demonstrated like this. And you're saying, I want to come back to Christ. I need to come back. He wants you back. He's been waiting on you. He never moved. You moved. Come back. If that's you and you prayed that prayer I prayed a moment ago, and it's the Holy Spirit's beating upon your heart, you ready to come home? I want you to come home. I want you to go right now and say, I'm coming home. Type that in the chat. Coming home. Just type it out. Coming home. Come on, be brave. Coming home. Make the devil out a liar. He's ugly and he sucks. Come on, write it out. Coming home. If that's you, I want you to go to www.allnationssa.com/. It's on the screen. It's pinned there. Click it. Fill out the information. We want you. We need you. Lastly, you need a place of worship. Right now, we're not meeting in a physical location. We're online, but we want to invite you to be a part of our e-church, our e-tribe. If you could do that, you want to be a part of All Nations San Antonio, we want you. We would be honored to be your leaders. Honored. Myself, our team, we'll be honored to serve you. Honored to be a part of your story and your journey, your walk with the Lord. If that's you, I want you to put find family in the chat. I found family. Found family. There you go. Found family. Put that in the chat. Found family. I want to welcome you to All Nations San Antonio. We'll be in touch. www.allnationssa.com/welcome. Make sure you fill that out. We want to welcome you to the tribe. Welcome you to our people. First of all, I want to bless all of you. Thank you for tuning in this broadcast. We bless you. We honor you in Jesus' name. Remember, this week, we're dealing with these vices to the glory of God. God bless you. I'm signing out from All Nations San Antonio, where we find family, discover purpose, change the world.
Oh my gosh, that was intense.
Yes.
Vices.
Bloody.
I mean, a bloody mess, wasn't it?
It was good.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. Guys, if you feel like I feel right now, I need you to go in the chats right now, and I need you to put your favorite moment. Yes. What was your favorite saying that Apostle said today? Put it in the chat right now, and I need you to share that thing all week. Take a picture of yourself or a nice little selfie and put in their vices, us. Oh my gosh, I can't even contain myself. I mean, that was so awesome.
Taking plenty of notes.
Woo!
But while you're doing that, I want you to go follow us on IG @AllNationsSA.
Yeah.
and on YouTube at All Nations San Antonio. This is where you can get all the up-to-date content that we put out all week long.
You did it.
Yeah, I did it. I didn't need Kevin. I can do this by myself.
Yes.
But I want you to go do that. Go follow us, go subscribe so you can get all the information, all right? Well, I mean, this is it. This is gonna ask us back.
You know they are. This is what we do. Put that in the chat. They were born for this. We want Pastor Lisa, Pastor Chris. We want people. We want the people. You know we have to say it saying every last time. 10 to win. 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 10 to win.
Tonight at 6:30 at the pull-up party. Pull up. Don't forget to pull up.
Because that's where we're going to find family.
Discover purpose.
And we're going to change the entire world. What?
Peace.
Come back.